Hey, this is James Riley.
And Beth Riley.
Another exciting edition of our Artist Spotlight podcast series. And Beth, who we have?
Today we have the boss of the blues, Mr. Jeff Fetterman.
How you doing?
I'm doing well. How about you?
Well, we're doing pretty good hanging in there during this pandemic that we got going on.
Yeah, it's crazy out here in Memphis. And so actually, the first thing that we talked to everybody about, how are you spending your time during this pandemic?
Oh, geez. Well, a lot of time now is actually being wasted without much production going on, you know?
Yeah.
A lot of ideas are starting to flow for new songs to be written and spending more time on practicing things and stuff like that. But as far as gigs and doing live shows, as we all know, they're pretty sparse and, you know, far and few between for sure. So the only thing I'm really doing is just trying to make the best of it and praying that everybody stays safe and healthy and we can get through this together and hopefully get back in 2021 with a new vendetta of getting out there and playing again and being back into the live music scene.
Well, one thing that you have been doing during this pandemic is celebrating a birthday. You just had a birthday on December 6th.
Happy birthday.
Thank you.
And we do want to let everybody know that even though it was a couple of days ago, you are still accepting gifts, so.
Right.
You are a self-taught guitarist, is that right?
Yes, I am.
Who inspired you to play guitar, and how old were you when you first started playing?
Well, actually, I really started wanting to play guitar or music or anything when I was at a very young age, like 5 and 6 years old. I would see like TV shows with like Hendrix on there or the Beatles or stuff like that, and it just made me feel really good watching it. I wanted to be like that. And as I got older, I actually wanted to be a drummer because I just always loved the beat, and I just really liked how the beat of, and even to this day still, I love the beat of the drums. And my parents weren't really gonna go along with the idea of getting me a drum set banging on them in the house when I was like 8 or 9 or 10, you know, whatever. So I actually started learning guitar at the age of about 13 years old. We had moved from one neighborhood to another, and there was a fellow that moved up the street where we moved into the new neighborhood, and he played in a band and they rehearsed in his garage, and I could hear the music coming down the street, and I decided to go up there one day, and that's all it took. It just lit the fire under my rear and really made me want to get into it. Been doing that ever since.
When did you first form the Jeff Fetterman Band? And also tell us some of the members of the band.
The Jeff Fetterman Band consists of now myself, obviously. I'm the guitarist and the sole songwriter and vocalist. And then my drummer, who is John McGuire. He's been with me now probably for about 13 years, I'm going to say. And then I have my bass player, Ralph Reitinger, the third. He's been with me, I'd say, probably about 6 years. Ralph is actually in the Rock Erie Hall of Fame as a bass player, and he's got, I think he's got more than 3 or 4 awards for that. He's won like 3 or 4 in a year in a row, and then he actually stopped, you know, people would actually submit him into the awards for as a recipient, and he actually told them to stop putting him in because he's pretty much the best bass player around. He's a winner year after year after year, and he felt it wasn't fair, and you know, and other people deserve to have a chance as well because he was always winning by a landslide. He's a young kid, and he's a phenom. He's been everywhere. He's traveled the world 2 or 3 times by the time he was 24, 25 years old. He's, you know, he had played with people like Anthony Gomes and Harper and the Midwest Kind. He was playing with them. So he's a great bass player, and I'm very, very lucky to have somebody like him. And actually, this band started probably a good 10 to 12 years ago. And what became to bring that about was I was playing in a lot of cover bands around the area where I live for years and years. Although we were successful, you know, doing cover music and making money and playing the clubs, I wasn't very happy musically and in my heart. I was bored and dead inside. I just didn't want to play other people's music. And so I finally had a night where the cover band I was in, we were playing. And at the end of the night, I was just like, you know, I'm really not into this kind of scene. I love playing, but I just, my heart's not content not writing my own stuff. I would rather write my own stuff and try to get somewhere other than being in a cover band. I wanted to take the next step further in the business. And then I asked the people who I was with, I asked them if they would like to join me. And of course, they all jumped ship and left me by myself. So, but that's okay, you know. And then I just started kind of playing around and contacting people and stuff. And, you know, and I've went through a couple of changes, but not too many. I mean, my drummer's been there with me for pretty much since like day one. He's went through everything with me. And I've went through a few bass players. And the only reason that being is just because, you know, there were creative differences, and also they, you know, they weren't as professional as I wanted them to be. And they also didn't want to shoot for that long-term goal of what I would like to have. So, and then we finally found Ralph, our bass player, and he was right on the same boat. And we've been together now with the three of us as a trio probably for about 5-6 years now. Yeah, since we picked up Ralph.
Now, your debut album with the band came out in 2000, The Long Hard Road.
Yeah, The Long Hard Road was actually kind of like my first, it was actually more like of a demo type EP coming out, where I wanted to get my music out there and let people hear what I was writing. And of course, that had a bunch of different musicians that I had been playing with back then.
Now, with a title like that, is that a biographical? Was it a long, hard road to get it out there?
Kind of a way, yeah, absolutely. I mean, because the music business, it's a tough road. I mean, you're fighting your way the whole time, you know, and even when you're seeing some successes, you're still actually fighting. When people become successful, they see the tip of the iceberg, like, oh, you know, they got this or that. What they don't see is once you see it underwater, there's this whole massive thing underwater that's just going to come out, you know. So it's not as easy as what people think. It is a very hard road to be a musician if, you know, if you're wanting to do that for your career and stuff.
The list of the awards that you have won, including self-produced CD, can you tell us about some of the awards that you have won?
Years ago, the first award I won was like Best Up and Coming Artist in Northeast Ohio. I'm in Pennsylvania, and, you know, and Ohio's not far from us, a couple hours. I was named, I guess it was like back in like 99, 98, somewhere in there, named as Best Up and Coming Blues Artist. And then I won the ASCAP Music Awards program, where they give you a monetary thing to help pay for studio time and stuff. It was kind of like a scholarship at the time type deal, what they were doing. I won that 1 year. The recent awards I have just won, I won the 2017 and 2018 Rock Erie Music Awards as Best Blues Band and Best Blues Album. So both categories on that. I know there's a couple more, but I just can't think of them off the top of my head right now.
You have a lot of influence by Kenny Wayne Shepherd.
Yes, yes. Okay. I'm very heavily influenced by Kenny and people like Jimi Hendrix and like Duane Allman. And I mean, there's a lot of influences. I listen to all different styles of music. I listen to everything from David Sanborn to Zeppelin to Prince to, you know, all the blues greats like Muddy Waters, Elmore James. You know, I love all styles of music. I actually got a chance to open up and do a show as a supporting act with Kenny Wayne Shepherd about 4 or 5 years ago in Pittsburgh. And him and I actually, we hit it off and we became friends. And I know him personally, and I've played probably a good 5 or 6 shows with him since. Great guy. I mean, every time he comes around the Pittsburgh area, he contacts me and he has me be a support act. And he's a very, very humble guy. I mean, for the successes that he has, he's a quiet, very humble guy. And he's just very, very nice. I respect him very deeply as a musician. And I respect him just as equally deeply as a person as well, because he's as great of a human being as he is a guitar player.
That's great. I mean, it's great when somebody can say that about someone else. That's really cool.
Yeah, he's very nice. He's influenced me not only musically but personally. He's made me want to be a better musician, obviously, but and just having, you know, my time hanging out with him and being around him and his camp and stuff, he's also made me want to become a better person as well. So, I mean, that's something to say. You know, it's a special person that can make somebody else want to do that.
Absolutely. Tell us about your album, Bottle Full of Blues. Quite a few years in between the first one and that one. Tell us a little bit about that record.
The Bottle Full of Blues came out, it was about 2016 or so. I spent a lot of time off from writing and playing for a few years just to kind of gather myself. You know, it was a point where I was, you know, not having the best of times within my own personal life, you know. So I had taken some time off from playing and that. And then I sat down and started writing. And that album actually, you know, come together pretty quick. I think it only took me maybe a couple, 3 or 4 months to write that whole album. And a lot of that stuff on that album is based off of personal issues and issues I've seen with other people and stuff as well. And actually, the Bottle Full of Blues was very successful. I mean, it sold quite a few copies for me, you know, being an independent. And right now on YouTube, it's got just a little shy under 2 million hits for the song title.
Now, you spent some time here in Memphis for the International Blues Challenge. How was that experience for you?
I loved it. I love being down south, and I love Memphis. I believe we went down in 17 and 18 and competed in the International Blues Challenge competition. First year, we made the semifinals, and then we didn't make it any further than that. And then the last year of 18, when we were there, we didn't even make the semifinals. But for me, it's not even about advancing. It's just being a part of the atmosphere and being around your own people, of the musicians and people inside the industry and stuff. I mean, that's what I like. Is to me, it's all about networking and meeting people and sharing experiences and stories. And the people down south, I love them. They're great people. I love the food. I love the culture. I love the weather. Of course, though, the first year we went down there, it ended up, you know, being in Pennsylvania. We're usually buried under 2 or 3 feet of snow and,
oh wow,
10 below zero from where we're at. And I go down there the first year and a snowstorm followed us all the way down. I think the high down there was like 11 or 13 the first year.
you never know what to expect out here weather-wise, yeah, that's for sure.
It was a good time. And then I was just like soaking in the area of where, you know, I mean, I've always been fascinated with Elvis Presley and just going around some of the places and saying, my God, he actually was here at this spot or at this location and stuff. And it was just kind of almost surreal trying to see how it would have been for him and stuff, you know. And I went into all the music stores and talked to people about Elvis, and they were telling me all these things. Oh yeah, his wife used to go to church over here and he used to hang out over here. And it's, you go to those places and it was like almost like a surreal thing. You couldn't even imagine it, you know.
I mean, I grew up an Elvis fan and I still geek out every time we drive past Graceland or Sun Studio, yeah, or something. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, a lot of history. I visited Sun Studios, and then, of course, I did have to make the pilgrimage to Graceland.
Sure.
You know, I went to Graceland the first year I went there, went inside, did the tour. It was pretty cool.
It's actually, yeah, it's really amazing to think of him spending there and just living. I'm trying to imagine what it was like when he was living out here. It's pretty crazy.
You released your fourth studio album earlier this year, entitled Southern Sun. Tell us about that album.
Oh, well, Southern Sun, that actually took me almost 2 years to write. I was working on songs, and then I'd have some together, and then I would scrap. I have a lot of throwaways on that album. I think there's like 12 songs on that album. One of them is only a cover. I did a cover of Bob Dylan's All Along the Watchtower, but we kind of did it our own way, like Hendrix did. But the other ones are all self-written songs. That Southern Sun there, the reason I named it Southern Sun, a lot of people ask what was with the title, is because even, you know, like I said, I love the South. I love the people. I love the culture. I love the weather, the atmosphere. I go down there a lot in the Carolinas, a lot in the summertime, and visit family and vacation there. So even though I'm living up north, way up north in Pennsylvania, I still have the South in my heart. So you know, it was kind of a cool name. I thought Southern Sun would be a good name for the album.
That is really good. You probably also wish you were here when it's, you know, really bad snowstorms or something up there.
Yeah. I mean, we've had a very mild winter so far. It's actually still fall up here, but we've been very lucky. We've only had probably 4 or 5 inches of snow so far. You know, sometimes right now it could start snowing in October and not quit till the end of, yeah, April. But yeah, and what started me writing on that song is I was really trying to put together some songs that I had been writing, and you know, of course I wanted to do a follow-up to the Bottle Full of Blues album. When I had all the songs pretty much put together, a friend of mine who lives in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, actually told me about the producer Kid Anderson, who lives out in San Jose, California, and he's the guitar player for Rick Estrin and the Nightcats, and he's a great producer. And I was told about him, so I contacted him, Kid Anderson, out there, and we set up a time when I could go out. And we went out, actually it was last February, we ended up going out there for like 10 or 12 days and recorded the album out there in San Jose.
So we'll put you on the spot here for a second. Name an artist that you wish you could work with, that maybe you haven't yet, and why you'd want to work with them.
I would love to work with Kenny Wayne Shepherd, actually. I'm really into him a lot, but I'm a massively, massively huge Bruce Springsteen fan. I would love,
cool,
to me, he's just a lyrical genius. The guy is just a phenomenal songwriter, probably one of the best that's ever lived. I would really love to see Springsteen, you know, but obviously I don't ever think that's ever going to happen. But I almost did get a chance to do a show with Greg Allman back in like 2010 or something like that, 2012, out in Pittsburgh. But he actually brought in a supporting act with him on the show. But he was one that I have always wanted to meet and do a show with, was Greg Allman. But unfortunately, that never happened. People that have known him and stuff, they say he was just a very humble man and, you know, a really good gentleman. And I just thought he was just a great writer and a great blues rocker. And I've always admired him.
Going back to the Bruce Springsteen thing, we are huge fans of The Boss in this household. just out of curiosity, did your nickname come from that, the boss of the blues?
My band members named me that just because of the fact, you know, the band is named after me. And the reason the band's named after me is because I'm the one that writes all the songs. I pay for all the studio time. I pay for all the travel. I take care of everything. You know, they kind of consider themselves my backup band. But in my opinion, I feel they're just as much part of the band as I am. You know, I mean, there's no leader in charge or anything. I mean, when there's things that's going to be decided on, I always get their opinions and stuff. But they gave me the nickname El Jefe, which is the boss.
Yeah.
and they know that I'm a huge Springsteen fan, so they just kind of gave me that nickname, the boss of the blues, because we're playing blues music and it gets kind of stuck. And then everywhere I go, people are calling me the boss of the blues, which is kind of, in a way, it's funny. You know, I find it humorous, but I think it's kind of, you know, neat in a way as well.
Now, we talk a lot about going back in time. We talk a lot about a time machine in this household. If you could travel back to any time in any year, what year would you pick?
I would go back into the area of Woodstock, 68, 69,
yeah.
Something like that. Yeah, I was born in 68, so that's been, you know, I mean, I was just, you know, just a baby back then. But I would actually, if I could, I would like to go to see the original Woodstock, because there were so many legends on that stage and during that show. And it's such a legendary concert in history as well as, you know, in the music. It's just like a legendary concert. And, you know, you had people like Hendrix, and you had the Jefferson Airplane, and you had Santana. I mean, the Who, there were so many main figures on that, and they were young in their prime too. I mean, they were all probably in their mid-20s, early 30s at the latest, and I think it would have been really cool to see them when they were first up and coming in that situation.
Also, I heard John Fogerty talk about, you know, Creedence playing there, but they played during the middle of the night, and like hardly anybody was awake or probably not sober. And so he said there's one guy yelling in the back, yeah, you know. Can you imagine seeing Creedence with most people being asleep during the middle of Woodstock?
I don't, and that's the thing. I think a lot of those people didn't realize who they actually had in front of them at the time. You know, I mean, they were all legendary performers.
You can tell a lot about somebody by, you know, looking at their record collection. And since we're not there looking at yours, if you could pick 3 to 5 albums that you'd take with, let's call it Desert Island Discs, that you just would have to have with you, what would those be?
I know I would have a Hendrix album. I'm not sure which one. I think everything he did was just incredible. I definitely have the Springsteen Born to Run album, without a doubt. I would have probably Kenny Wayne Shepherd's Deja Voodoo album. I'd probably have a Prince album in there somewhere. Not sure which one, because I like all of his stuff. Doesn't matter which album. And then probably just some good classic rock, like, you know, maybe Led Zeppelin 2 or something would be an excellent one to have as well.
Oh, nice.
Kenny Wayne Shepherd, if you could pick a song out of his catalog, one song, what would you pick? I have mine. I'll tell you mine, but you got to tell me yours.
It would be a toss-up between Deja Voodoo, and it would be a toss-up between that and Slow Ride. I don't know, because they're both really, really great songs.
Yeah.
They are.
You know, it's like put a kid in a candy store and tell him to pick one candy bar. You don't know which one he's going to want.
Yeah. I'm a huge fan of him as well. I would pick Blue on Black. I like that one a lot.
Yeah, it's a great song. Yeah. That's probably his biggest hit as well. And I know that, I think the band is named, I think it's Five Finger Death Punch, just did a remake of that not too long ago as well.
Let's get back to you. I'm sorry. I'm not trying to talk about Kenny Wayne Shepherd. What is next for you? What's next for Jeff Fetterman? You got any upcoming projects or anything you're working on?
Well, the only thing I'm really working on right now is wanting to get back out as hopefully as soon as we can, like, you know, like every other musician, and get back on the road and start getting gigs under our belt and booking shows, because this new album that we have, the Southern Sun album, is fairly still new and not heard a lot, because when we actually got back from California in February of last year, 2 weeks after we got back, then the COVID hit and everything shut down 2 weeks after we come back. So we've been at a standstill since then. So I'm excited for it to be over, and hopefully things will be moving on soon and we can get out and start promoting that album really good and, you know, getting the show back on the road. That's what I'm wanting.
How can people find out information about you?
They can find me at jefffetterman.com. That would be spelled JefffetterMan.com. That would be my website. They can find me on Facebook at facebook.com/Jeff Fetterman Band. That's our band webpage on Facebook. Our music can be streamed pretty much anywhere on all major music platforms like Spotify, Deezer, Apple, iTunes, and such. You know, just punch us in and we can be found there as well. YouTube, you can punch us in on YouTube. You can see a lot of videos and music.
And you also have a new item available on your website.
Just release the masks, yes.
Very cool.
Yeah, you got to promote those.
Yeah, we have those, the little Jeff Fetterman Band masks, and it's basically our logo. It's black, and then it's got the little JFB pick. It's like a guitar pick logo. It's on the side of the mask. We sell those online as well with our CDs that are available for purchase on the website.
Well, Jeff, man, thanks so much for spending the time with us and getting to know you a little bit better and about your past projects, your current project, and what you got coming up, and even some Desert Island discs. Now we're going to have to do some homework and listen to some of those, and maybe we can compare notes later.
Sure, absolutely. Thanks a lot, guys.
Thank you.
See you now.